Thank you very much, Michael. It's a great pleasure to come across the river to King's from University College London. And we were talking over lunch at how, you know, there are so many great colleges and places of learning in the centre of London, and yet sometimes we forget. So it's a pleasure to hear more about what's happening here and how, you know, the academics and the learning support work together. And I think that's really important, especially as technology becomes increasingly diverse, and there are many things we can do with technology to try and enhance learning. So the topic of my talk today is very much something that I have passion about, which is trying to get children and my own students to have a sense of wonderment when they're learning and when they come into the classroom, not just to sit there and go through the slides that I prepared earlier, but they're really genuinely excited about learning and also not knowing what's coming next. And I've been greatly inspired in my work by the pedagogy of Piaget, who I'm sure you all know very well. But this is a quote that's often cited, and I think it refers not just to children but to learners in general. It says, when you teach a child something, you take away forever his or her chance of discovering it for himself. And I think this observation is even more profound given the modern academe's relentless push towards ever more personalised learning. And what I mean by that, developing technology that can measure students' performance, that can rectify their errors, and also can reward their completion of tasks. It's very much towards the performance end, rather than letting the student or the child themselves discover and learn, you know, for them. And so in my talk, I'm very much focused on how we can design technologies to encourage or to enable children and students to learn. And this is the second part of his quote that I think is very much behind our philosophy, which is, you know, that which we allow him to discover by himself will remain with him visibly. And I think that's very important to think about. By discovering, by enabling students to learn for themselves, that sticks with them in their minds, rather than us giving it to them on a plate, so to speak. So I'm going to try and convince you of the importance of how suspense, not knowing, is integral to that learning experience. A year ago, someone again from a university, this time it's LSE, sent out a tweet, and he was a professor of human rights, Connor Gearty, and the tweet he sent out to his students, and I'll read this out, was simply, "Gorilla lecture later this evening, tickets to be issued at 6:45 in the foyer of New Academy building, LSE only, I'm afraid." That was all that was sent out as a tweet. And you can imagine the students were very intrigued, but also lecturers were intrigued. And so there was a link that you could link to, and all of the students linked to this. And this is what was on that webpage. And it says, an event on Thursday, 24th of October, involving gorillas, hell and commandos. Without giving too much away, it involves the Institute of Public Affairs, led by Professor Connor Gearty, who is pioneering a new style of lecturing at LSE. Forget traditional lecture halls and think instead of an intellectual form of a flash mob. Keen to experience a unique, engaging, thought-provoking evening, interested in discussing a controversial subject in a location that very few get the chance to see. Now, who wouldn't want to follow that? And it got a lot of the students intrigued, and then they, you know, they told their friends, and everyone was, you know, getting very excited. There was also FOMO, which is fear of missing out. So, what happened? Well, all the students who were signed up for this course, there were 40 of them, and many more people who weren't on the course also showed up at the place that they had to assemble, and they were all put onto a bus, and they were taken to Westminster Cathedral, and taken into a crypt. And this is the crypt here you can see on the slide. And they were met by the professor, also an expert on cults and religion, and a chaplain. And the topic that they were asked to discuss was, what is the worst thing about hell? What is hell? And why is the idea of hell so enduring? Where has hell gone? And so they were split up into three groups, as you can see here. This is nothing, you know, out of the ordinary. We often do this, split up into smaller groups. But they discussed these questions at length and very deeply. And then they came back together and talked about their answers to these questions. And afterwards they were, you know, then they all tweeted about this and put pictures up, and it got lots of publicity as a different way of holding a seminar on a topic in religion which people might not be that excited by. And when they were asked if they knew this was what the topic was going to be about, most of them said, well, they probably wouldn't have come along. But it was because of not knowing, this excitement of going somewhere, that they were drawn into this. And then when they were in that context, they were very much engaged in the topic. So I think the message here is that the background, the context and the setting can very much engender a sense of that not knowing, that discovery and that suspense. I was just talking to Michael earlier how some of my students, I take them to, because we're near to the British Library and the British Museum, I take them to the British Museum and I show them one of my favourite exhibits. And then I'll say to them, and then we'll sit down and have tea and have a tutorial. And it's a great leveller because they're not coming into my classroom, but they're in this beautiful, wonderful place. And then I say, well, next week I'd like you to take me to an exhibit and say to me why you think that, you know, is interesting to you. So it's a great icebreaker, but it also changes very much the context of that sometimes painful one-on-one tutorial or that seminar that you might have. Last year I was also lucky to be invited to be a fellow at the San Francisco Exploratorium. Those of you who don't know, it's a hands-on museum, a bit like the Science Museum here, but it's got much more funding and it's got much more innovation in the technology that they've developed and the way in which they teach science there. And it's always crowded with kids. And one of the philosophies they have is that they hire 16 to 18 year olds. They pay them to explain, they're called explainers, and they explain various topics in science and physics and biology to whoever might be there. And they do this every hour. And this one here is about the cow's eye. How do cows see? And what this explainer has in the hands is an actual cow's eye. And they dissect this cow's eye in front of whoever happens to be there and explaining to them how, you know, all the different layers of muscle and fat and what's at the back of the eye, the lens, the optic nerve, and they start to peel away and show, and right at the back of the eye of the cow's eye is this beautiful turquoise, and they get to see that, and then eventually they get to see the lens, which is like a jewel. But what you can see here is these kids get nearer and nearer and nearer, and they keep, you know, and she has to keep telling them to get away a bit, but she's always asking them questions and they're always putting their hands up, like, why does a cow have a third eyelid? Anyone know? It's because when they're down munching in the grass and the thistles, they don't want to scratch their eye. So this third eyelid comes down and it stops. And that's something I remembered from being there, because I hadn't really thought about that. And why do we not have a third eyelid? Because most of us don't munch grass and put our heads down there. Anyway, so this was, you know, went on for about 20 minutes, and it's one of the most popular events that happens at the Exploratorium. Kids just love it. They love to see all this black stuff oozing out, but they also, it's fascinating, and they get to feel the iris, the eye. It's put in a plastic bag, so they move it around, and they get to look through the lens and think about why things appear upside down. There have also been a number of the explainers put themselves on YouTube and do the same thing. And I want to play you this video here, which I think the same format, the script, is used.
Hi, my name's Katie Fleming. I'm an explainer at the Exploratorium, and I've worked here for about 3 years. We do cow eye dissections, and we get our eyes from local meat distributors. And I've probably conducted a cow eye dissection 4 times a week for the last 3 years. So that's a lot of eyes.
But there's a big difference here, is that she's very clear in her explanation and quite engaging, but it's not the same as actually being in exploratorium and that kind of sensation of feeling the eye, but also just being gripped. And it's very much the children being part of that, the audience. You never know who will come along. Parents would also come and adults would come and sit, wanting to know what's going on. If you wanted to see how, and this has some nice diagrams which you don't have in the actual museum, but there's a contrast between this being quite flat compared to what we saw in the exploratorium. So I think part of this is very much, the suspense. They weren't sure what was going to come next. So what do I mean by suspense? Well, I think the common definition is very much a state of feeling of excitement or anxious uncertainty about what may happen next. And it's a very intense feeling that you have when you're waiting for something to happen or something to occur. And the way in which you design for it is you build up a tension between someone's anticipation of what's going to happen and not knowing what to expect next. And some of the great dramas that we see on TV use this to the max, this idea of suspense. And it has you on the edge of your seat, literally, sometimes. And why would we want to do this? I hope I can show you through some of the technologies we've designed, is that I think it leads to guessing about what might happen. Children and students are actively involved in thinking about it, and that can lead to spontaneous inquiry. So, as I said, suspense as a mechanism is often used to draw people into games, into movies, and into novels. You know, we have this idea of the page turner sitting on the edge of one's seat, and it's a powerful literary tool that is well known in TV shows and series. You're just coming to something that's going to happen, and then it stops and says, "Come back next week." And that guarantees that you will come and watch it next week. But in learning, there is far less suspense or the thinking about that in the design of the curriculum and in lesson planning. And instead, there's been much more focus on explicating the learning goals, the objectives and the aims beforehand, so students know exactly what's going to happen, what's going to be in a course. And each term, when I have to prepare my lectures, I dread whatever else I'm being asked to specify on Moodle, all of the things that the students need to be able to know, because it takes the suspense, kills the joy by them just sort of knowing that this is what they need to learn and this is what's going to happen. And also we're now being asked to say what activities and what skill set students will have at the end of this course. So I'm going to describe three case studies now where we've tried to think about bringing some suspense into the learning activities through designing technology in innovative ways. And the first case study was a project we conducted quite a while ago now, which was called the Ambient Wood Project from 15 years ago. And we wanted to create a field trip with a difference. There were things called PDAs and mobile technology that was coming out. We were very interested in how we could employ this in giving children the opportunity to look around a woodland and find things out for themselves, but not to just give them access to the internet, but to give them contextualized information and be able to collect data there and then that would enable them to discover more by themselves, to initiate their inquiries, and not to tell them much before, not to give much away. And so this project was conducted with lots of people whose names I won't read out, but we had psychologists, we had educational technology people, we had computer scientists, we had hardware engineers, and we were very much interested in how we could be innovative in the technology design. How could we create a Wi-Fi hotspot in the woodland? This was before we had things called 3G. And also thinking about the infrastructure as much as the learning experience and the design of the technology. So it's a big project, but I think there were some lessons learned from this that I want to mention here today. So just to reiterate, we wanted 10 to 12 year olds to go out into this woodland. It happened to be one of my colleagues who'd got this big woodland, bought it, and he was saying, well, at the moment only my wife does yoga there. I said, could we borrow your woodland to have it as our living lab? And he was very happy for us to do something there. So we wanted to encourage these children, it was about 20 miles from their school, to come out and, using all of these new devices we'd created, to explore the woodland, to make the invisible visible, and for them to come up with hypotheses as to why something was the way it was, and to try and put the knowledge they'd been learning in the classroom very much into the woodland for them to experience. So one of the first things we had to do was to create this Wi-Fi hotspot. And so we just put laptops into trees and had aerials hanging down. And what we discovered is when children were going round in the woodland, they were as much fascinated by this seeing a laptop up in a tree and understanding what its role was. So they were intrigued by the technology as much as what they could discover with the devices we created for them. One of the devices that we created was through working with a design student from the Royal College of Art. And she created this thing called the periscope. And this is an organic installation that simply shows videos of ecosystems. But what's different about this is it's not just a handheld device, but it's this thing on a stick, which she repurposed from bicycle handles, that you move this installation around by moving these handles, and then you want to try and get a crosswire in the middle, and clicking on that will play a video. So as you can see in the second image, you can see a video, they've managed to achieve this. And the idea here was not that you watch the video in the classroom and then go and try and find it out there, it was that you watched it whilst you're in the woodland, and immediately you could, if it was about the bluebell histories, or the life cycle of the bluebells, you would go out straight afterwards. And so putting something in context we thought was very important. So here are two girls, they've discovered it, they're a bit apprehensive at first, but then they get the hang of what to do.
I think we need to control where it goes.
Oh, you can tell. So
if we look, if I think we can make it look at different places.
In April, English oaks rebuild.
That, so after they'd watched it was only for about a minute, that was about the oaks, they went looking for acorns and started to think about what was being presented. So that proved to be successful at getting kids to think and to prime them into thinking about what they were seeing. Another device we developed was called this probing device, which was designed by one of our engineers. It's a very simple device that you can measure moisture and light and dark, and you just turn a switch to do one or the other. Now there's no display on this device, it goes somewhere else. So every reading you just click and press a button goes somewhere else. And this, the reading of the moisture or light, appears on this other mobile device as simple visualizations. And our idea was that one child would go off probe and the other would get the reading and then call out that's darker or that's lighter than the last one, and that they would work together. And so having these devices yoked in that way was very effective at getting them to work and collaborate together, rather than just having one kid going off taking a reading and having a look at it. And this triggered lots of conversations and interactions and generation of hypotheses. And this is something that we've worked on quite a lot, is how do you constrain hardware and software to encourage collaboration and reflection? And this was one of the first attempts to do that. And of course, what we find is that kids being kids, that they, Felix here on the left is measuring his armpit to see how damp and how dark it is. And you can see from their faces just how much fun they were having to sort of, for themselves, to think about where to go and measure. And I think that's important, is to have that kind of, you know, playfulness and joy included in the design. And here again, part of the suspense is you take the measurement and you wait for it to appear as those visualizations, not just numbers, but something that you can read immediately. Little did they know that every recording or every probe they took we recorded, we were tracking them, and then we re-represented them as dots on a bird's eye view of the area that they'd been to. So each, there were pairs of children that went out into the woodland for about an hour, and then they were called back into a makeshift classroom, which was a den. And for that hour or so, they did about 200 probes. We couldn't stop them. They didn't want to come back into this classroom. They wanted to keep probing. But when they eventually did, they were able to see all of the little dots were their probes. And they were absolutely fascinated that we'd collected that data. And they would click on these dots and then discuss what the context was. Was it very dark? Was it wet? Was there a pond there? Or so on. And they would describe it to the other pairs of children. And to get 12-year-old boys to talk about the data they've collected and to understand it is quite difficult. But here, we couldn't stop them talking about the data they'd collected. And having this bird's eye view, they could see all of the different data points. And this follows on from another person that we've been inspired by, which was Edith Ackerman, where she talks about how children or adults, you know, need to switch between the here and now experiences and then reflect on those by stepping back. So diving in and stepping back. So they were diving in measuring and now they're able to step back and see this bird's eye view. And that seems to be a very effective way of triggering reflection. But part of the suspense was we didn't let them know in advance. And so when they came here, they were absolutely marveled about it. I've since met a couple of the kids who are now adults. And they say one of the things that, or perhaps one of the only things I remember about school was going on that field trip in the ambient wood. And they regale that day with great joy and pleasure because of all of the not knowing and the discovering these new devices and technologies, but also what was invisible and making it visible in the woodland. So there's an example of some early work we did by creating these devices and thinking about the data that you can collect and also you can present to students. The second case study is some work that we're currently doing now, which is thinking about adding suspense to make learners struggle and succeed. And we're teaching them about electronics and the Internet of Things. And here it's very much trying to get the students to have a sense of achievement when they've made something, and to encourage collaboration and explore more possibilities in what you might do with these new technologies. Don't know how many of you have done electronics before, but part of the making or creating is putting all of these wires onto the breadboard, and it can be very fiddly and frustrating. And what we wanted to do is to create a toolkit whereby this wasn't the main focus, but it was more on what you could do with the technology and thinking about the concepts under the Internet of Things. And so what we did was we combined two of our own kits, Make Me and Sense Me, and sat that on an existing toolkit called Arduino. And this project is called the Magic Cubes Project. I'm just going to describe some of the aspects of what I think was important in its design. The first thing we did was we wanted to make the entry point really low, so anyone from 3 years up to 90 years could have a go. And we also wanted to make it affordable, so the idea was that this would be a couple of pounds to make and that we could give these away. We were working with the BBC at the time, who were very much interested in promoting coding amongst children. But it would be that you snap these pieces out and then you have to work out what to do with them, which is to make a cube. And that process, you start to learn about what's on each side. So on one side, there's an LED light, another there's a battery, another there's an accelerometer. And then once you've put the pieces together, you make this cube and you can see inside it. And unfortunately, the batteries run out on this one, but you can then discover what happens with the cube. And what happens with the cube is that it lights up. But there's more to it than that, that if you start shaking the cube, it changes color. And if you move it in different directions, it also changes color. And that's the discovery that the children had, is having made the cubes, they could then discover. So here's just a short video. Just
I think you need to pick them.
Yes. Okay, if you shake the cube different speed, you get different colors.
If you shake it really slow, you get purple.
That's it.
Like this.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Oh, too slow.
That's it, purple.
I got, no.
That's a purple.
Oh, it's purple.
Yeah. How about if you shake it really, 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 really fast?
Multicolored.
That's it.
You just got purple rabbit.
Yellow. Phrase that everyone wants to buy.
I hope so. Is it fun? Okay, so we do a different activity now.
Okay.
Yeah? We know where the button is. Where is it?
Here.
It's this funny wiggly thing, isn't it? So if you touch it, the lights go in and out, fading in and out like that. So we know that we are in the right mode. This is quite a difficult challenge because you need to do these directions. Okay? Let's try to do a red one. So to do red, you have to shake 1, 2, 3.
Purple?
You have to press the button when you are shaking it.
Oh, I got red.
So try to hold it this way. So hold it. One finger pressing the button and one finger pressing the light and then shake it.
Oh,
wait until it finished flashing.
Oh, I got red! Yay!
Have you? Yeah. Oh yeah, you've got red. Yes, and you've got red.
Okay.
How do you connect these to computers to program them?
Oh, at the moment, you need a special connector to do this. So there are 6 pins on there. But one of the other things we found, we ran lots of workshops to see how children would, you know, to do this making exercise and how they would collaborate. And you can see, you know, just on their faces how much they were found it taxing and engaging. But then we also found that once they'd made the cube, they wanted to show it to everyone else in the room. Here's a group of school kids. And then some of the kids who were having a bit of difficulty putting these sides together, they would point out and help the others. So there's a lot of show and tell and helping out. And that's something that we really, weren't expecting to that extent. But then another thing that happened was that as soon as they'd made their cubes, they all stood up and walked around the classroom, shaking them and showing each other. So having that, you know, spontaneous just getting up and moving around was something that we thought was, you know, quite, you know, for us it was a discovery as well. But one of the people, the questions that we're asked is, well, what's the value of making? Why don't you just give kids these cubes and let them shake them and start to, you know, point out the different components, the sensors and actuators? So one of my students ran a study to show what the value was to actually having to make the cubes. So she experimented with two conditions. One was a ready-made cube like the one you've got there, and the other where they actually had to make the cube before And then were asked to do various activities with it. So 100 children aged 6 to 11 years old across the two schools were asked to carry out these different tasks. And then in order to measure making, there isn't a ready-made set of measurements out there, but we came up with a combination of qualitative and quantitative. So first of all, acknowledged their test scores, and this was multiple choice, where we asked them things about what was an accelerometer, what was a sensor, what was an actuator. And these are things that they'd been taught and learnt through making the cubes, or that they were taught 5 minutes before for those who'd been given the ready-made cubes. We also observed what the kids were doing throughout the class, and then we had a survey. So this was a number of rating scales that the children were asked to rate after the class to see what level of engagement. Then, because we were interested in collaboration, we collected video of what happened during the class and looked at some of the collaborations and interactions that took place between the different children. And then finally, our other measure was of what we're calling creative appropriation. This is where we were interested in what kinds of ideas the children came up with, how much creativity and discussion they had with the other children. So those were our four measures. In terms of the test scores, we did find a difference between those who'd been given them ready-made cube versus those who had to make it, but primarily amongst the younger children. So you can see from this diagram here that for the 6 to 8 year olds, when they'd been given the cube that they had to make themselves, they got a higher test score than when they were just given the cube. So that suggests to us the process of making improved their retention of what they'd been taught. Whereas for the older kids, we think we got a ceiling effect. There wasn't much difference between those two. But I think it showed that had we perhaps given the older children more complex making tasks, we might have equally got similar types of results. So we won't go through that. So that was our test scores. In terms of engagement and collaboration, we found that there wasn't any difference at all between the children because they rated the activity highly. All of them thought it was a great activity, whether they were making it or it was ready made. Then in terms of collaboration, we found that most of the children collaborated when they were making the cubes, but the younger ones, just like you saw in the video, they're very proud to show off the cubes that they'd made. And in the making condition, they also set up a collaborative relationship right from the beginning of the class, and that continued all the way through. So they bonded at the beginning through this making, showing and telling. So that was something that I think, you know, it's not something you can easily measure, but came through from this. Then in terms of this idea of creative appropriation, there was a difference between what and how the children discussed the making activity. So those who had to make the cubes from the start, it kind of slowed down their thinking and stimulated ideas at the level of changing the components into something new. So they talk about, well, what they could do with the cube was, let's maybe have a face scanner, so when someone comes into my bedroom, I can detect if it's, you know, my mum or my dad. Maybe we could have use it as an ambient display to show there's a disco in here. And so they started thinking of a range of activities in terms of the components that they put together. Whereas those who'd just been given the ready-made cube, they started talking about it in terms of each one being a building block. So they're suggesting things like, well, we could build a tower, we could put one cube on top of another. So the act of making affected at what level of granularity they would talk about ideas that could be generated. And I think we're not saying that one is better than the other, but that you do get different kinds of discussion and ideas generated depending in whether you're making. So that study we did last year, and it's been published. And the second step of our research is to think, once you've got kids or adults engaged at this level, how do you move on to the next step? How do you get them to start coding? How do you get them to look at all the different sensors that are possible? And so this is where we built our next cube, which is a bit more expensive, but it's got more sensors on it. It can measure light, it can measure temperature, It can measure heart rate, and it's also got not just one light, but a matrix of LEDs that can have different colours. And what I think this video will show here is, again, you get the same level of collaboration and engagement when using this cube, but also for learning to code. So they can code these cubes to make things happen. From that short video, you can see just how engaged they were. They were showing and telling and what they'd coded, and putting the sensor up to the light to see how light it was, and that would appear on the LED matrix, and then crawling underneath desks and chairs to see if they could get the darkest place, a bit like the ambient wood. And so it's very for them to learn how to write or make little animations. So this one here, I don't know if you can read that. So I just did this one earlier, but you can take, you know, you plug it into your computer and you can quickly change a template to change that, or you can quickly come up with animations. This one here, it's it can give you the temperature, which is quite warm in here. Then if you shake this, this smiley is not very happy. If I give it a good shake, no, it's gone. Anyway, so there are different ways in which you can program these cubes. So it's getting them to move up to another level. What these cubes can also do is that they can be Bluetooth. So you can start to have a set of 20 or 30 of these cubes eventually, and you could maybe have the whole classroom think about some kind of light show or a music show, or starting to think about how we can combine these and how we can code with these. So this has led us to start thinking not about digital literacy, but about something we're calling digital fluency, which is what we're trying to do is to think of how you can encourage different kinds of thinking in the context of making. And the different types of thinking we're calling the four C's, which is computational thinking, creative thinking, critical thinking, and connected thinking. And we're trying to not just encourage one or the other, but that they're able to move between these types of thinking through these different activities. So showing to each other, sharing ideas, making, coding, finding a problem to solve, then trying to solve it, reflecting on that and exploring. So we think that we shouldn't just be teaching kids to code, but we should be teaching them to think about how they might do that in a broader and wider context. And so that's why we're suggesting this idea of digital fluency is more apt than thinking about digital literacy, because we think that the next generation will need to have a much broader way of thinking about how you can code all of these different technologies. It's not just about designing an app or programming an app that they'll need to do. We can have sensors in the carpet, in the walls, and for them to think about what might we do with these and how might we code these. And so we think it's giving them that basic set of skills in order to do this sort of more joined up or many different kinds of thinking. This case study was done a few years ago when I was at the Open University, and it's in moving from electronics and science into the humanities. And we were very interested in working with teachers who are in history and drama and thinking about how We can add suspense to make connections between the present and past so that the students find it much more engaging. And as I've said throughout, we wanted to foster a sense of wonderment, but also encourage collaboration amongst these students and promote what we're calling evocative computing. And what do we mean by evocative computing? We mean giving opportunities to students and learners for them to trigger personal memories or for them to surface in their ongoing activities that will result in them being forged and cemented in deep and long-lasting ways. So how might we do this? How do we create this form of evocation? Well, we again designed some interconnected devices, handheld devices like tablets and smartphones, but also we tried to use these in combination with technology that could be used indoors that would connect. So the tablets and the smartphones, they could use to take photos and they could bring up information, but they could also then send this information somewhere else. And I think it's probably easier to show you how it worked. These children who were older, 14 to 16 year olds, in a drama class were asked to go to a cemetery in Cambridge and to look up, do some research about World War II and the soldiers who had died, and their gravestones were in this cemetery. And up until we came along, the drama teacher had got them just to sort of have a look at the inscriptions and to think about, you know, what was behind that. What we wanted to do was to make, just like the ambient wood, to make this a bit more engaging, that they could find out more. So they could take photos, but also they could bring up information about the history of that particular soldier or that particular person whose name was engraved. And you can see them here taking photos, but also looking at information on the smart phone. The information could then, the photos, could be then sent indoors to what is a tabletop, a shared tabletop technology, where again we had a bird's eye view of the cemetery. Anytime someone took a photo, that would appear on this display. And people who were inside could click on bits of the display to find out what was happening outside in the cemetery. So those outside could communicate with those inside by sending them photos. So you can see here on the left, there's the map of the cemetery with blue blobs and red blobs. The blue blobs is where photos have been taken, and the red blobs are where they could still take some photos and find out more information. They found it absolutely fascinating that the photos that they'd taken, again, they could click on and see them on this display inside, but also to find out more information. And then they could communicate via phones back to people who were outside. So we were trying to bring the outside and the inside together and to let them discover more and to feel very much engaged in something that can be quite difficult, understanding the past. There were a bunch of volunteers who came along and helped on these sessions, where there were groups of potentially 15 or 20 school kids coming to do their research. And one of the volunteers happened to be a history teacher, and he happened to be just walking along when he saw these two kids bring up the blob here, over here, for John Robert Seeley, who died, and his gravestone was there. And he couldn't believe it. He got so excited. John Seeley, is that really him? He's a really, really great man. Professor John Seeley, he's the big researcher into the British Empire. I'll have to go back. And that means go back outside into the cemetery and find him now. Well, that's amazing. Not quite like finding Shakespeare, but yet it's on the same scale. And that unexpected discovery of one of his heroes by just happening to walk past led to him talking to all the students around him about this infamous Mr. John Seeley, who was a history professor. And he had lots of infamous dinner parties at Cambridge, and he started telling them the history and the stories about these. And the kids again were gripped by this anecdotal, or this, you know, richer history that's not to be discovered by just looking at information on the gravestones. And so they were all drawn into his stories, and he then went out and had photos taken, and then he continued bringing his students into into that cemetery to discover more about this Mr. John Seeley. So we asked the students afterwards what their experience was, and here's an example of one who said, "It's odd that when you're in the cemetery, you only think of the person's death, where they died, when and how they died, and yet when you're here and look into it more, you think of their life." And so that opened up that evocation. And so something by using existing technology, which was laptops and smartphones, and using a content management system to be able to move the content that was being collected in real time onto a tabletop, was able to bring this alive. So one of the teachers who was involved mentioned, "It's also exactly how I think they should research. Hands-on, out there learning. Whereas before I would have encouraged pupils to make lots of notes when visiting places to help them start preparing for their narratives, I now tell them to bring their phones to school so they can make photos of the things that strike them as special or unusual in order to be able to remember where they were." So that shift and using technology enabled a quite different experience of doing research in this drama class. So I just want to step back now and think about these three case studies that I've described to you, and hopefully think about how technology can be designed and used to encourage this discovery and reflection and collaboration and the joy of learning, awareness of each other and intrigue. And I hope I've been able to convince you that adding suspense can make a difference, and a big difference, to the different kinds of learning activities. So I want to leave you with, instead of some takeaway message, takeaway questions. So I've shown you how in these three case studies how we design for suspense. But how do you design for suspense? It's not something that you can just say, right, I'm going to have a bit here, or design my lesson to have it here, and I can measure this. It's very much a frame of mind than a set of guidelines. And I think good teachers are ones who perhaps do that intuitively. They know how to keep their students sitting on the edge of their seats, how to engage them and keep them, wondering what's going to happen next. Some people have asked me, well, can suspense be sustained throughout multiple learning experiences? Surely they must get tired, the students, of having something happen which they weren't expecting. And I think students never tire of surprises. They're always wanting something to be surprising or unexpected. Another question is, how much of the learning experience should be engineered and how much should be left uncertain? How much should be ambiguous so that the student has to work out what it is they're learning and why, rather than we script what exactly they should be learning? And I hope that certainly there does need to be some scaffolding and materials and perhaps some activities, but leaving it a bit more uncertain encourages students to explore and to try and work out for themselves. And I think that we are losing a lot of that in modern academe. And finally, should all learning have not knowing at its core? I would argue yes, but I'm probably in the minority. I think that just like Piaget was arguing, is that you've got to let the students discover for themselves.